this video, we're going to define the product sigma-algebra, which will be essential to define the product measure. Before I start, let me remind you that you can support the channel in a few different ways. You can donate on Ko-fi, become a member on Patreon, or buy t-shirts and other things in our store. Let me start by defining an algebra. I'm going to change notations a little bit. Let's say I have two sigma-algebras, M1 and M2. And in the previous video I was using the letter B, I'm going to reserve that letter just for the Borel sigma algebra. So we have just two sigma algebras. And I want to define the product sigma algebra. Well, I'm going to start with something smaller. I'm going to start with an algebra that is going to be just a set of any possible union of rectangles. That means I'm going to take unions up to n of sets, let's say ei times fi, where n is just some natural number. So I'm going to start with only one union, then two unions, three unions, and so on. And then ei and fi are on each sigma algebra. So ei is in M1, fi is in M2. So this is just take sets in your sigma algebra, product them, and then union them. You take all possible unions, and then what you have is that this thing here is an algebra. And so this, we're doing it for two sigma algebras, but of course we can just continue. And if I have a countable amount of sigma algebras, I can define the product in a similar way. But things get a bit trickier when we get to uncountable. And that's why some books, instead of defining the product algebra like this, they define it in terms of projections. So basically they take a set in each sigma algebra and consider all the cylinders by taking the pre-image under the projection map. So that's a bit more complicated. In the case of countable products, it's equivalent to this, but it's useful in cases where you don't have a countable amount of sigma algebras. So I'm just going to write so that you know what I'm talking about. That sigma, that algebra is usually written as given the projection, let's say, onto the case coordinate. You take the pre-image of that projection for some set ek, where ek is in the sigma algebra mk, and k is in some set k that can be uncountable. So in the case where k is countable, in this case k would be 1 and 2, these two definitions are the same. But this one is better because it also works in cases where the product is uncountable. But it gets complicated because you now have to consider cylinders instead of rectangles. And I think that rectangles are just a lot more intuitive. So in this reproduction list, we will only worry about countable products. So I'm just going to ignore this definition. But of course, you can choose either because they're both equivalent in the cases of countable products. So let's move on. We have an algebra and we want to define a sigma algebra. Well, we just do the usual thing. We're going to define it M1 product with a circle, M2, or the same countable, of course, as the sigma algebra generated by this algebra. So, of course, the sigma algebra generated by anything is a sigma algebra. So this is a sigma algebra. And so with this, we pretty much are done. But I do want to continue just a bit more, because even though we're doing this theory all in abstract, we're basically worried about Lebesgue measure. And we are usually concerned with calculating measures of things that are in the real numbers. So of course, I'm just going to focus now a bit more on that and give a proposition that's only valid for the Borel sigma algebra on the real line. So this theorem is extremely specific because we're only now focusing on the real numbers. But what it's saying is that the Borel sigma algebra of Rn plus m is equal to the product sigma algebra of the Rn Borel sigma algebra times the Rm Borel sigma algebra. Also, this gives immediately that the Borel sigma algebra of Rn is just the product of Borel sigma algebras of the real line n times. So let's say from I equals 1 up to n, you just take the same Borel sigma algebra of the open intervals in the real numbers. You just take the product sigma algebra using this construction that we just saw. And if you do that n times, you end up with the Borel sigma algebra of Rn. That's amazing. This is a bit more general, and it's saying, well, the same, that you can just decompose it as any product you want, but always considering here the product sigma algebra. So let's prove this. Let's start by showing this inclusion. And so for this, what I'm going to do is define AK to be the set of products of intervals. So I have an interval B1 and I product it with K intervals. So up to AK, BK, where all these numbers are just real numbers. And if I take some set A that's in AN plus M, so there will be products of intervals up to AN plus M, then of course I can just divide this set into the product of N intervals times the product of K intervals. So basically what I'm saying is I can write A as A prime times A double prime, where A prime is just an element of AN and A double prime in AM. So I can write any set in AN plus M as a product of N intervals times a product of M intervals. So what I'm saying is that A is part of, well, not the sigma algebra yet, but the product with a square, the algebra product of Rn and Rm, the sigma algebras. And of course, this, because it generates the product sigma algebra, well, of course, this is a subset of the product sigma algebra. And now this is valid for every element A in AN plus M. So what I'm saying is that AN plus M is a subset of the product sigma algebra. And so if I have something that's a subset of a sigma algebra, then in particular, the sigma algebra generated by this will also be a subset of this sigma algebra. Well, but the sigma algebra generated by An plus M, An plus M is just products of intervals. So this is the definition of the sigma algebra for N plus M. And so this sigma algebra is contained in the product sigma algebra. Great, that proves one of the inclusions, and now we have to prove the other one. And this other direction is quite straightforward. If we have, let's say, that A prime is in the Borel sigma algebra of Rn, and A double prime in the Borel sigma algebra of Rm, then it's not too difficult to see that the product of these two elements is in the Borel sigma algebra of Rn plus M. And so this immediately is giving us that the algebra product of Rn with the product sigma algebra of Rm is a subset of the Borel sigma algebra of Rn plus m. So now I have some set that's a subset of a sigma algebra. Then, just like before, now the sigma algebra of this will also be a subset of the sigma algebra. And the sigma algebra generated by the product algebra is the product sigma algebra. So this is BRn product BRm. And this is the other inclusion that we were trying to prove. And with that, we finish our proof for this very nice theorem regarding Borel sigma algebras only for the real numbers.